We turn again to James chapter 1. We were thinking last week about how to receive the Word of God. Now, this is indeed a very important subject, because often we are told to study the Word of God. We tell new converts, spend time studying the Word of God. But interestingly enough, in Scripture, the exhortation is not to study the Word of God, but rather to obey the Word of God. It is through obedience that we come to understand what Scripture deals with. And we are to present ourselves to God as those who understand God's Word, workmen that need not to be ashamed, and for that we are to be diligent, not just in studying academically, but in obedience, in humility. Now, if we understand James verses chapter 1, verses 1 to 20, 21 to 25, we shall discover how to approach the Word of God. And let's look at that again. We are to put aside all filthiness, James 1:21, all wickedness. In other words, if my heart is not clean, I cannot understand what God is saying. I cannot hear God. My ears will be stopped. I will be like a deaf man if my heart is not clean. I will be like a man with blind eyes trying to read a book. No, it is a clean conscience. The eye of our heart is the conscience. And Jesus said, keep your eye clean. If your eye is clean, your whole body is full of light. And if we want the light of God's Word, our eye, that is our conscience, must be clean. And if a man's conscience is not clean, then no matter how much he studies the Word of God, he will come to the wrong conclusion, however wise and however intelligent he may be. Now that's something you need to remember, dear friend. But if your conscience is not clean, however much you may study the Word of God, you will come to the wrong conclusion. And God himself will allow you to come to the wrong conclusion. We are told in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 11 that God sends upon certain people a spirit of delusion, a deluding influence, so that they might believe what is false. Now, many people can't think that God would allow people to believe what is false, but here it says so clearly. God will allow people to believe what is false because, verse 10 of 2 Thessalonians 2, because they did not receive the love of the truth in their heart. So if I do not love reality, truth means reality, in my heart, if I am not walking in the light before God with a clean conscience, with all filthiness and wickedness, with a heart that is not cleansed, then I shall not understand the truth. God will allow a deluding influence to come so that I believe what is false even when I study the doctrines of Scripture. This is one book in the world that needs a clean heart, not just a clever mind. In fact, you don't need a clever mind at all. All you need is a clean heart when you come to the Word of God to understand what God is saying. You don't have to be discouraged that you can't go to a Bible school. You don't have to be discouraged that your intelligence or your memory is not very good. None of these things will disqualify you from understanding God's truth. Only one thing will disqualify you, and that is an unclean heart or a proud heart. It says here further in James 1:21 that it is in humility that we are to receive the Word implanted. In a gentleness of heart, then that Word can be planted within me. Planted through obedience, not just through study. And so it says in verse 22, prove yourselves doers of the Word, James 1:22, and not merely hearers. Now when a man hears the Word of God, he may increase in knowledge and understanding, but still he will be like the man who built his house on the sand. We are told in Luke's Gospel, chapter 6, and verse 49, that the one who hears my word and does not do it is like a man who built his house on the ground without any foundation. Whereas the man who hears my word and does them will be like a man who builds his house who dug deep and laid a foundation upon the rock. So you will be like a house without a foundation if you merely hear and understand and study the Scriptures. Many people don't understand that. They think they hear the Word of God, they appreciate it, they understand it, they're able to explain it, they're able to preach it, but they are still like people without a foundation who will one day collapse because there's been no obedience. Whereas Jesus said in Luke 6:47 and 48 that the one who hears my word and does it is like a man who digs deep and lays his foundation on a rock. When God's word speaks to you about repenting from all sin, putting aside all filthiness and all wickedness, setting all matters right with God and man, and if you obey that, you dig deep. If you turn from all known sin in your life, and you set right everything with all human beings, that your conscience is clear before all men, that if you have wronged someone, you apologize, if you have taken something wrongfully, you give it back, and you settle everything like that, whether it is with the government or with the office or any human being, that everything is settled, then I dig deep. Now that takes time. It does take time, just like it takes time to lay a foundation for a house. We can't build a house overnight. No, it takes time to lay the foundation. If you don't lay a foundation, your work is superficial. And the foolish man's house looked just the same on the outside, but when the test came, it fell. And so, dear friend, we need to major on that part of the house which lies beneath the surface, which people cannot see. That is the foundation. And for that foundation, we need to obey the word of God. Then the word will be deeply implanted in us, and whatever storm or test comes, we shall not shake. But if we hear and do not do, then we deceive ourselves. And God allows us to be deceived. Because we are like a man who looks at his face in a mirror. He sees perhaps, or perhaps he doesn't even see the spots in his face. Because he looks so hastily and goes away, he doesn't even see the dirt on his face. But if we look and look intently, like it says in verse 25, at the perfect law, then the perfect law, like a mirror, shows me my defects. And then I can judge myself and forsake those things, settle those things, set those things right with God and man, and seek for the cleansing of the blood of Christ, and seek to obey the word of God in that area where that perfect law has shown me my deficiencies. Then I become, James 1:25, not a forgetful hearer, but an effectual doer, and this man shall be blessed in what he does. Now here's a tremendous promise, that if we want to be blessed in what we do, then we need to look intently at the word of God and obey it. If I do not look intently at God's word and obey it, then God's blessing does not rest upon what I do. We read in Psalm 1, the opening paragraph of the book of Psalms is, how blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, does not stand in the path of sinners, does not sit in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. He doesn't just meditate in order to increase in understanding. No, he meditates, and the result of his meditation is described in verse 1 of Psalm 1, that he does not walk in the counsel of the wicked. He walks in the counsel of God. He does not stand in the path of sinners, nor does he sit in the seat of scoffers. He's forsaken all that, and he walks in God's ways as a result of his meditating in Scripture day and night. And then he will be like a tree planted by the waters. And it says in Psalm 1:3, words similar to what we just read, the last part, whatever he does, he prospers. And that's God's will for us too, that whatever we do, his blessing may rest upon us and that we may prosper. And that's what it says in James 1:25, that when we become effectual doers of the word, we are blessed in whatever we do. Whatever we do, God's blessing comes upon us if we commit ourselves to obedience. It is thus that the word takes root in our life, is planted deep within our hearts, and that word, which contains the seed of the divine nature, God's power is in his word, manifests the divine nature through us. We are told in 1 Peter 1 that we are born again through the word of God, and that seed which is incorruptible brings forth in us the incorruptible life of God.